Professor Eric Dursteler, professor of history and chair at Brigham Young University, focuses his research on gender, religious identity, and food in the early modern Mediterranean. His publications include latest book titled The Mediterranean World, From the Fall of Rome to the Rise of Napoleon, which is co-authored with Monique O’Connell, and that was published earlier, published this year. The title for today's presentation, Christian or Muslim, Proving Who You Are in the Early Modern Mediterranean. Please join me in welcoming back Professor Eric Dursteler.
Thanks, Corey, and it's good to be back at the Kennedy Center. Lots of good friends here. I appreciate the invitation. And thanks to you for coming out. I want to talk to you today about how you identify yourself, how we can identify ourselves. I think in the contemporary world, we have a lot of different ways that we can do that. I can, you know, pull out my driver's license. I've got a passport at home. Could have a picture, perhaps, that I can show to identify myself. If we want to get really clever, we might do fingerprints or DNA or even a retinal scan or something like that. There are lots of different ways in which we can identify individuals, even people who don't want to be identified, even people who might be trying to hide behind a false identity or something like that. The question I have today is, how do you do that in the 16th century Mediterranean or anywhere? Before the modern era, for that matter, how do you show who you are? Particularly, as we'll see in the story I'm going to tell you today, when the stakes are pretty high. So I want to tell you the story about an incident that happened in the Mediterranean in 1596. So, if I can get this to go forward, there we go. So the story starts here in the island of Chios, just off the coast of what is modern-day Turkey, when a man from Santorini, another Greek island, Demetrio di Antonio, and three other Greek men set out in a small boat from this Ottoman island, ruled by the Ottoman Empire, headed into the Aegean, looking for salt. Trading for salt, pretty common sort of a commodity that was traded for in this time period. And they sailed a little bit south and near the island of Mykonos that you can see on this slide. They were set upon by a larger boat, not a really large boat though, what's called a felucca, that was captained by a certain Alessandro Beccaforte, who was probably not a corsair or what we might call a pirate, but probably just an opportunistic sort of small-scale merchant who took advantage of an opportunity and became what we might describe as an occasional pirate. And this is pretty common in this time period. It's kind of an era of semi-anarchy, I think we can say, in the Mediterranean. And so this kind of activity on large, medium, and small scales is pretty common. So Demetrio is grabbed by Beccaforte and the other men on Demetrio's boat as well. The three men who are with him are released, but Demetrio's captors believe that he was a renegade Christian. That is, that he was someone who had converted to Islam, and that, in fact, his name was Mustafa, and that he was married to a Muslim woman. And so, therefore, as a renegade Christian, a convert to Islam, he was fair game to take captive and enslave and to sell on one of the many Mediterranean slave emporia. And slavery, when we think of slavery, we think about the Atlantic world. There are probably 3 million slaves in the Mediterranean from 1500 to 1800 or so, kind of the heyday of this period. So slaving is very, very common. It's not racial like it is in the Atlantic. There are certainly sub-Saharan black African slaves, but probably more white slaves from all over the region. And so it's a very common occurrence for somebody to be grabbed and enslaved, and that's what happens to Demetrio. He's hauled from Mykonos to Malta, which is small island in kind of the middle of the Mediterranean, just south of Sicily, which is probably the most important Christian slave emporium, the biggest slave trading sort of center in the Mediterranean. Malta You see a little detail here from some contemporary images, was controlled by the Spanish crown, but had been turned over to the Knights of Malta, or the Knights of St. John, a crusading, military crusading order of monks who take all of the vows that a normal monk takes, but are militaristic. They battle, and their usual foe is Islam or Muslims. So Malta is given to the Knights of St. John. There are about 30,000 people that live on the island in this time period. They speak kind of an Arabic dialect. The island itself had at one time been part of the larger Islamic world, but by 1530, it was definitely Christian, and almost all of the inhabitants are Roman Catholic. Pretty small island, Malta and Gozo, the neighboring island, about 122 square miles, not very big, really, at all. It's about 250 miles from North Africa, the North African coast. The rulers of Malta are the Knights of Malta. Here you see a depiction of one of these. This crusading order, you know, probably a couple hundred is all on the island, who dedicate their lives largely to piracy, Christian piracy, against Muslim merchants, but as we'll see, not just. So Demetrio is brought to Malta, and he's sold to Fra Ippolito Malaspina, who, as the name suggests, is an Italian knight of Malta. And the knights come from all over Europe. He happens to be Italian, and he's a hero, an important sort of heroic figure from a recent battle, the Battle of Lepanto in 1572. And so he's a well-known figure, a very rich corsair. He's a friend of Caravaggio, for our art historians out there. Caravaggio gets in trouble in Rome, as you know, and has to skip town. And he goes to Malta, of all places, and paints some really important works there, including this piece that you're looking at here. And Malaspina is a patron, actually, of Caravaggio's. So Malaspina is a pretty important figure, and he buys this slave. With this transaction, Demetrio becomes one of about 3,000, so about 10% of the total population of Malta, who are slaves. Around the turn of the century. And he's going to be, he can work in any number of different sectors, maybe in agriculture, maybe a household slave. Most likely for a pretty young man like himself, he's going to be a galley slave. And he's going to row on the galleys of the Knights of Malta. They're using some wind power, but they have a couple hundred rowers on the ships, and he's going to be one of those. Chained to the oars, lifetime sentence, not a pretty life at all. So this is what happens to Demetrio. His fortunes change pretty dramatically. A few months after Malaspina buys him, Demetrio reveals, and I'm going to start quoting him from the record of his trial in the Inquisition. He says, "I was a Christian, and I fasted on Wednesday in the Greek fashion, and I did not want to eat the meat that was given to me on that day." He said he'd been reciting his prayers in Greek, and he knew how to make the sign of the cross. And this is enough to make Malaspina, his master, question whether, in fact, Demetrio is Mustafa, or, in fact, as he keeps claiming, this Greek Christian, this Orthodox Christian. So what Malaspina does is what is very common in Malta and other places, is that he takes Demetrio to the Inquisition, to the Maltese Inquisition, a branch of the Roman Inquisition on the island, and asks them to figure it out, asks them to dig into this question. He says, Alessandro Beccaforte, the guy who sold him, Demetrio Mustafa, claimed that this guy was a Muslim, and he says he's Christian. Can you get to the bottom of this question? So we should say a word or two about the Inquisition just for a second. Of course, all heard of the Inquisition. We have certain notions about what that might entail. The Inquisition in Malta was on this little island. Here's the main island, or more main part of the port Valletta, and here is what's called Big Borgo or Vittoriosa, and that's where the Inquisition was located. And you can see it right there. It's a big building. You can still go visit it. I think I might even have a slide. There it is. Right now, that's the Inquisitor's Palace. You can go and visit in Malta. And so this is where Demetrio Mustafa is taken by his master Malaspina. And he's taken before this guy right here, Innocenzo del Bufalo de Cancellieri, who is the inquisitor in Malta in this time period, in 1596. Bufalo de Cancellieri is a Roman nobleman. He'll eventually become a cardinal. You can tell that because of that little cardinal hat right there on his coat of arms. So he's a pretty important figure. And he's sent to Malta actually just for a year or two and goes back to Rome, and his career goes on. He is one of the more prominent inquisitors in this time period at the end of the 16th century. So this is the guy that Demetrio is going to meet. Now, when we think of the Inquisition, we think of stuff like this: people being tortured, people being put to death, burnt, drawn and quartered, all sorts of bad things like that. And we have this kind of dark legend, black legend sort of notion of the Inquisition. The Inquisition is a complex institution. It's a place that has very specific and rigorous rules of evidence, of inquiry. It is probably one of the best organized, most rationalized courts in Europe in this time period. It's an ecclesiastical court, so it doesn't deal with civil crime. There's another civil crime court in Malta that does that. So it's just ecclesiastical issues, heresy, apostasy, as might be the case with our friend Demetrio. But most of the cases in Malta that Bufalo de Cancellieri deals with, the inquisitor deals with, are not sort of these bigger issues, but things like magic. And here's a page from one of the superstitions. This is a page from one of the inquisitorial volumes. I spend way too much time staring at these pages, and there are hundreds of volumes of these cases, because the Inquisition keeps really careful records of everything that's said, both by the inquisitor and by those who are being interrogated, even to the point that when this is happening, which is the primary way that they're tortured, hung up from the ceiling like that on their toes and then lifted, so it dislocates your shoulders, not very pleasant. They record the cries of agony that the individuals make when they're being tortured. Most are not tortured. Almost nobody is put to death. The objective is reconciliation to the Christian community. So there certainly is torture, there certainly is death, but it's exceptional and rare. In a place like Malta, we're talking about a few cases of individuals being put to death. And most people are not tortured, but some are. Not excusing what happens there, but just to sort of contextualize it. So in the case of our friend Demetrio, the Inquisition is trying to figure out who he is. Who is this guy? He claims to be Christian. Others say that he's Muslim. How do we get to the bottom of this is the question that faces them. And at the core of this inquiry is, of course, this question of identity and how you establish that in a place like the Mediterranean, which is extremely mobile. People are traveling all over the place, moving back and forth, men, women. It's extremely mobile, connected sort of a region. And so how do you show who you are? How do you prove who you are? The early modern period, the period that I'm telling you about, is an age that has been described as an age of deception. Montaigne, who you see here, Michel de Montaigne, a famous French intellectual of this period, he said, quote, "Dissimulation is among the most notable qualities of this century," which is to say everybody is hiding something, or a lot of people are hiding things. For those of you who are historians or are looking for a good work of history, one of the most famous works of what we call microhistory in the latter part of the 20th century is a book by a historian named Natalie Zeman Davis entitled The Return of Martin Guerre. And it's the story of misrepresentation. It's a story of a man actually who presents himself as being the husband of a woman coming back from the wars, the Spanish and French wars, and he claims to be this woman's wife and husband, and ends up being an imposter, which is kind of an interesting case, right? How can you really not identify your husband? And that's sort of what leads to this very famous case that ends up being recorded and becomes the basis of Natalie Davis's book and actually a pretty good French movie about the case. And so there's a rich scholarship, actually, that, about this age of deception that that I'm talking about here. There are frauds, imposters, cross-dressers, aspiring saints, mountebanks, charlatans, lots of people who are dissimulating or faking, lying, presenting themselves as something that they're not. In fact, there's a special term that's used to describe these kind of people, which is Nicodemites. Nicodemite is somebody who practices dissimulation. It comes from John Calvin, the great Protestant reformer, referring to the episode in John 3 of Nicodemus. You may remember the Pharisee who comes to visit Jesus, a member of the Sanhedrin, actually, comes to visit Jesus by night. He's a pious Jew by day, but at night he's interested in talking with this Jewish prophet. And for Calvin, that's the kind of the quintessential example of a two-faced individual. So in Reformation Europe, in this period that we're talking about, both Roman Catholics and Protestants generally believed that masking your inner belief with external sorts of professions that were not consistent with your internal belief, that is, lying about your religious identity, was acceptable. That you could do that, and that was acceptable because of the dangerous politics of the age. Your religious identity could be a matter of life and death, and there'd been plenty of religious violence throughout Europe in this time period, and so this was considered to be an acceptable practice. The same was true in Islam. Muslims call this taqiyya, which is known as, outward conformity. So conforming to the Christian religion or something else outwardly, but maintaining on the inside in your heart, a different, your true sort of an identity. A Muslim cleric wrote, "God is not concerned with your exterior attitude, but with the intention of your hearts." And Jewish scholars said effectively the same thing, that it was okay to lie about your religion and to even not fulfill the basic religious requirements of that faith. You could break kosher or halal if necessary in order to preserve your life. So in an age in which it's hard to say who's who and in which people are actively lying about who they are to preserve or to protect themselves, identifying who somebody is becomes a big kind of question. How do you do that? How do you prove? If you're an inquisitor, if you're Bufalo de Cancellieri in 1596 and Demetrio comes before you, how do you decide if he's Mustafa or Demetrio? This is the question that the Inquisition is faced with. So Malta is kind of an interesting place to go back to our little island. It is, as I said, about 250 miles or so from the coast of North Africa. It is a 30-minute plane ride from Sicily, very close, you know, maybe not even 100 miles, 100 at most, let's say. It is right smack dab at sort of the intersection of the Mediterranean, the crossroads of the Mediterranean. It's been described as being situated at the bottleneck of the Mediterranean, where you have to really pass by very closely to go east or west and north and south as well. And so it's a magnet for people from all over the region. It's a small place, but a lot of people come and go from this area. And as I said before, it's the capital of Christian piracy. The Knights of Malta are the biggest Christian corsairs in the Mediterranean. And that's how they pay the bills. That's how they build the walls of their cities. That's how they live pretty richly, is through slave trading. And the slaves that they're trading primarily are Muslim slaves, though there are a fair number of Christian slaves that get thrown into the mix as well. The result is that Malta is a place of mixing. It's a place where Christians and Jews and Muslims live side to side. It's a place where lots of people convert and become Christian from other faiths. And so it's an interesting place of mixing. And so it's not uncommon. What Demetrio does is not at all uncommon. Slaves that are brought from all over the Mediterranean to Malta really regularly go to the Inquisition and say, hey, I'm a Christian. I can't be a slave. I can't be enslaved. I'm a Christian. You need to verify that and free me. Usually, if they are a Muslim or acknowledge that they're a Muslim, they'll claim that they were forcibly converted. So yes, I am a Muslim, but in my heart, I dissimulated, and in my heart, I remained a Christian, and I was forced to become a Muslim, and my real identity is as a Christian. So this creates a real sort of complex situation and kind of a tension that the Inquisition exists to deal with. Part of the tension in Malta is that these people are commodities, right? They are merchandise. They are valuable. They were purchased or captured and then sold, and so there's an economic value attached to them. And I'm showing you, this is not Malta, actually. This is in Algiers on the North African coast, one of the major Muslim slave trading emporia. But slaving is such an important part of the economy and so valuable that there are, you know, real economic interests that are involved in this. And Greeks are especially common in this slave trade, traded by both Muslims and Christians. The Greek islands are highly exposed, and so what happens to Demetrio and his shipmates is a really common occurrence. And conversion by Greek Orthodox to Islam is pretty common occurrence as well. In fact, we know that the Knights of Malta are aware of this and that they're taking advantage of that and that they're targeting Greek merchants because they can get away with it. So they're not just trading. This is not a holy war. This is often depicted as being a holy war, but it's not about Christians and Muslims only. That's an element, but it's about money and the value of slaves. And so Muslim slave traders sell Muslims and Christians sell Christians and vice versa. In the 16th century, just to give you sort of a point of reference economically, a good slave, a beautiful woman or a healthy male rower could slave the equivalent of about 10 tons of wheat. And that's, you know, that's not chump change. Religious authorities and even political authorities try to control this and try to ensure that the only people Christians are only selling Muslims, and Muslims are only selling Christians. But as I said, it gets really murky really quickly. So this brings us back to Demetrio, who we started with, and the Inquisitor Bufalo dei Cancellieri, and how he goes about trying to figure out who this guy is and decide whether he should remain a slave or be set free. And so there's a kind of a lengthy inquisitorial trial into this question, and I want to tell you about that to sort of take us to the conclusion and tell you how Bufalo dei Cancellieri tries to resolve this conundrum that he's facing. And it shows us in many ways how people establish their identity in this time period. So Alessandro Beccaforte, the merchant who snagged Demetrio and sold him, is called into the inquisitorial palace and asked to give his version of events. Tell us what happened. And he says that when the small boat that Demetrio was on approached Mykonos, the island, that he and his felucca grabbed the men on the boat, and that they found that three of the four of them were dressed in the Greek fashion. And all, quote, all three of them had black hair, alla grecesca, in the Greek fashion, in the style of the archipelago. So their hair identified them, and their clothing identified them. Demetrio, in contrast, Beccaforte says, was dressed like a Turk. That's his quote. He says, I knew he was a Turk because he had a turban on his head, which he removed and threw inside the boat when he saw us. So he's trying to cover up who he is by hiding his hat. And here's some examples of the various different turbans. And actually, turbans are a mark of social status. Their color, their size, all say something about you. So this is kind of the quintessential marker of a Muslim identity, even though lots of Christians wear turbans all over the place. But for Beccaforte, his hat made him a Muslim. In addition to that, his shoes identified him as a Muslim. And a lot of the images I'm showing you are out of travelers' costume books and accounts from this time period. It's very common for individuals and artists to sort of sketch who they encountered and draw turbans, and in this case, these shoes that you see depicted here. So Beccaforte says, Demetrio was dressed like a Turk. He had his turban, he wore a blue Turkish vest and Turkish shoes. And when he took off his hat, he had a tuft of hair in the middle of his head like the Turks do. Again, quote, all of these are quotations from his testimony. When asked by the inquisitor why Beccaforte didn't think the other men whom he'd captured and let go were Muslims, Beccaforte once again says talks about the way that they were dressed. He knew that they were Greeks, quote, because they were dressed in the Christian style and wore clothing like Greek sailors from those parts of the archipelago, and as well as wearing their hair and their beards like men from that region. As Beccaforte's testimony indicates to us, one of the ways in which identity was articulated, one of the ways in which you identified yourself to others was through clothing. Costume was an important part of identity. Though, as we see from this case, a really easy one to get rid of, right? Throw away your hat, take off your jacket, strip down if necessary. I mentioned to you that it's really common to have travelers going through this region and sketching and drawing people that they encounter. These are mostly men, and so they draw mostly women. Some things don't change, I guess. And so there are hundreds of these sorts of images. I'm just showing you a couple. But what you can see written above is this is a woman who is from a certain town near Istanbul, and this is a woman from Cyprus. And while their clothing may look similar to us, to this traveler, there are enough differences that this is sort of a national costume almost. Here's another very famous book, and you can actually see pages out of the book. This traveler, Peter Mundy, bought these little postcards, that image in the middle there of an Ottoman chef, a cook in the Sultan's palace, is actually a card that you can remove. It's pasted into the book, as are those little cutouts. Those are actually cutouts of green paper, really beautiful sorts of leaves. You can see that even better in this one of Muslim woman on her high heels. You notice right there, very beautiful gown that she has on, but all of these are pasted in, and they're cut out of different colors of fine kind of tissue like paper. It's really a beautiful volume. And then here's the account, Mundy's account of his travels and these individuals he encountered. So in Istanbul, you can buy these things just at a postcard store, basically. They're all hand-drawn, but they're super common, super spread all throughout Europe from travelers in this time period. And part of this is sort of like a book of identity, right? You can flip these open and you can look and you can identify who somebody is because of the clothing that they're wearing. Costume, according to contemporaries, serves to distinguish, quote, distinguish individuals from various regions according to their habits, which is to say their clothing, what they're wearing. So that's one of the ways that Bufalo de Cancellieri, the inquisitor, tries to figure out who Demetrio is. Another way that he does this is to approach it from a linguistic angle, right? Your language can identify you in some ways. According to Beccaforte, who captured Demetrio, Demetrio was bilingual. He says he always spoke Greek with his captors and fellow sailors, but he also spoke Turkish with several other Muslims who were taken captive later during the voyage to Malta. This is only mildly helpful, though, because the Mediterranean is an extremely linguistically diverse and multilingual sort of a place. Because there's so much movement, you kind of got to know how to speak or at least get by in languages. And so it's not uncommon for people to speak Greek or Arabic or Italian, a version of Italian, which is kind of the lingua franca that everybody is probably going to know. And in fact, that's what they're speaking in this inquiry is Italian between them. So that's not super helpful, but that is one of the angles that the inquisitor takes to try to figure out who this guy is. They call in other witnesses, another servant from Malaspina's household, who testifies about Demetrio. So he's captured, he's sold, he's in Malaspina's household, and one of his fellow servants, slaves, comes and says and testifies to the Inquisition. He says this: at the beginning, when Demetrio was purchased and brought to the house, he lived as a Turk and ate meat on Friday, which seems unclear to us or strange. I eat meat on Friday pretty regularly. That's when I go out with my wife. What's the big deal? Well, for Roman Catholics in the early modern period, Friday, every Friday is a fast day. It's a day in which you can't eat meat, can't eat eggs, other sort of animal byproducts. So it's a fish day. If any of you lived in areas where there was a large Roman Catholic population, maybe at school you found out that on Friday they often serve fish. And that's because that's a Catholic feast day, a day of fasting. And so the fact that he was eating meat on that day for this fellow slave was evidence that he was not Christian. Now, he's not a Roman Catholic, right? He's Greek. He's Orthodox, and the Orthodox fast day is Wednesday. So it's a bit of a problem here as well. And that's what Demetrio says. He says, I'm a Greek Orthodox, right? I'm from the archipelago. I fast on Wednesday, and I did fast on Wednesday in the Greek fashion, quote, he says, and did not want to eat meat on that day. So food is another way that the Inquisition tries to get to this thorny question of who is Demetrio Mustafa. Food is an important marker of religious identity. It's something that we engage with every single day, right? And so food becomes kind of a marker of who you are, particularly in religious terms. Food taboos are an important marker of this. An example of how this plays out with the Inquisition is in the Iberian Peninsula, in Spain and in Portugal, where Muslims who convert to Christianity and Jews who convert to Christianity, so-called Moriscos and conversos, the Inquisition is, you know, always keeping an eye on them because they're not certain of the sincerity of those conversions. And one of the things that they always look at is their food. And so they will actually have officials, officers of the Inquisition, go into the Jewish or formerly Jewish parts of town on Friday and find if they're cooking certain Jewish meals. Or they'll go and make sure they're cooking pork, right? If you're eating pork, then you're a Christian. If you're not, then you're a Jew or a Muslim, or that's the suspicion of the Inquisition. Doesn't matter if you don't like pork, right? If you just don't like bacon, they'll still sit down and say, eat some bacon, and prove that you're a Christian. The final way, and the way that I want to conclude with, that the Inquisition goes about this, and perhaps the most effective way in answering this question of is Demetrio a Muslim or a Christian, focuses on what the records sort of politely describe as Demetrio's membro virile. I'm going to let you translate in your own mind. His virile member. His body. So we're going to talk about that a little bit. So when the two boats initially encounter each other off the island of Mykonos, when Alessandro grabs Demetrio, he has his suspicions because of the turban and the clothing, right? And so to prove him to himself that this guy is Muslim, Beccaforte says, quote, in the presence of my men, I had him pull down his pants. One of his crew members who was present at this time said that Demetrio's member was Turkish because it was cut. I saw it, which is to say he was circumcised. That's what they're talking about, beating around the bush, basically. For Beccaforte, that's the final straw. This is the decisive sort of a factor. You can't take that off, right? Once you're circumcised, you're always circumcised, except actually it is sort of reversible, and there are doctors who will do it in this time period for you. But for him, it's his circumcision. For Beccaforte, it's Demetrio's circumcision that marks him as a Muslim. Demetrio knows that he's circumcised, of course, right? And he realizes that this is going to be important to establish in his religious identity. So what Demetrio says when questioned about this circumcision is that he was forcibly circumcised by Beccaforte with a razor because he intended to sell me as a Turk. I'm sorry for those of you who have sort of weak stomach. I'm slightly feeling unwell myself with all of this talk of razors and things, but I'm not going to go any farther with that. So Demetrio says, I was forcibly circumcised by the guy that grabbed me so he could sell me as a slave. And this happens. This is not a made-up story. This happens. So what the Inquisition does is what it always does. It called a doctor. because they have a physician on call whose job is to go and inspect circumcisions. And they call Calorino Brigata, a Christian physician who had been a slave himself in Muslim lands for 15 years, and so knew something about circumcision from those years. And they have him go into the prison of the Inquisition and inspect Demetrio. And Brigata said, "I have treated, quote, treated many Turks," and he reported that Demetrio's membro virile was only cut on the upper side in a half moon. You're going to know so much more about circumcisions after this day than you ever knew before. This is a special day. So he says his circumcision is a half moon, only cut on the top. And he says this is kind of strange, because in his experience, the physician's experience, the, quote, Turks usually cut all the skin that is around the tip of the virile member in a circular fashion and not in the way that Demetrio's foreskin was cut. Because of this, Brigata says, "I am certain that this Demetrio was not cut in the way that the Turks usually do." And he says, while he could not judge, quote, whether the cut was fresh or old, it did not appear that Demetrio had been circumcised in childhood. The Inquisition has got to get the facts straight, right? So this is not enough. They send two Arab slaves to inspect Demetrio as well, right? Guys who should know something about Turkish or Muslim practices with circumcision. One of them is a slave, another is a free man that's just living on Malta. And they come back and they confirm that he was not circumscribed in the way of, quote, we Moors and Arabs. And one of them says, "I am certain that he was not cut by an expert and experienced person such as cuts Arabs. And it seems to me that the incision is not too old. Rather, it must be about a year old." Still a complex question, right? It's not entirely clear what's going on here. The question of circumcision is an important one because it's widely known throughout the Mediterranean that this is something that's practiced by both Muslims and Jews. Christians know about this. They know that this marking of the flesh is a really important sort of marker, external physical marker of religious identity, right? You can change your food ways, you can eat bacon or not, you can change your clothing, but a circumcision is not something that you can change. That's a near permanent sort of a mark. And this is therefore a powerful sort of a marker of identity. What makes it a little more complex, though, is that not everybody becomes a Muslim or is circumcised as a child. So there are hundreds of thousands of converts, many of them voluntary, who convert and may be circumcised as adults or may not be circumcised at all. It's not even a requirement necessarily in certain areas. So it's not sufficient evidence to convict. In fact, one contemporary traveler talking about circumcision, writing in North Africa, says that in the admittance of a renegado, a renegade, or the denier of his first religion, circumcision is not exacted of the Moors for fear that the undergoing of such a painful sacrament should deter the proselytes, which seems reasonable to me, right? They're fearful that people won't convert because they have to get circumcised. So in the end, it takes several months for the Inquisition to get to the bottom of this story. And at a certain point, they have what is described as the rigoroso esame of Demetrio, which is to say they torture him to try to figure it out. They hang him up like that and question him. And in the end, the inquisitor, Bufalo de Cancellieri, accepts his story and declares Demetrio to be a Christian. We don't have his judgment, so we don't know the rationale or the reasoning, what he found compelling and convincing. But in the end, he declares that Demetrio should be free like all other Christians. He has some questions, and he makes Demetrio do penance, but in the end that he frees him. Time doesn't permit, but it would be really interesting to think about how you establish identity for women in this time period. And there's some interesting cases from the Maltese Inquisition in which there are not physical markers of identity. Female circumcision is not widely practiced in the Mediterranean, so you can't really use that. So how do you tell if a woman is a Muslim or a Christian? Let me just conclude. As this case, I think, shows us, there are some real serious challenges in establishing who a person is and whether they're Christian or Muslim in this time period. On the one level, we have the initial encounter between Beccaforte and Demetrio, in which Beccaforte had to identify whether there were any individuals on the small boat who represented potential merchandise as slaves. These kinds of encounters were extremely common in this time period and fraught with all sorts of potential dangers. Beccaforte goes through a checklist of sorts, according to his version of events. He looks at clothing. He looks at physical appearance. He listens to their speech and the names that they call each other, and then he examines ultimately their bodies to establish whether these are legitimate slaves or not. The inquisitorial tribunal represents a different kind of an inquiry into this question of identity. It's an institutional sort of an attempt to establish who this individual is. As in the original encounter at sea, Buffalo de Cancellieri pursues a detailed line of questioning that parallels much of what Beccaforte had originally done. He looks at clothing, physical appearance, language, circumcision, food ways. All are examined in an attempt to conclude who was who. In both instances, though, the issue at hand was Demetrio's religious identity, or perhaps better, his external adherence to one of the Mediterranean's religions. The questioning focused not on what he believed, right? There weren't questions beyond, can you do the cross and say our Father, the Pater Noster. Beyond that, it's not about what you believe. It's about these external sorts of manifestations of your faith, your body, your food, your clothing, your speech, not what's in your heart, though that's where religious identity is supposed to reside. How do you get to the heart? That's a hard one. And so it's what you do. It's praxis rather than belief. The performative aspects of religion rather than the belief system. As one scholar has noted, contemporary societies attempted to clarify and articulate identity through documents and through clearly delineated national borders. That's how we do it today. In the early modern Mediterranean, one wore one's identity quite literally on one's sleeve, on one's tongue, on one's head, on one's body, and on one's palate. Thank you very much.
We've got a few minutes left for questions.
Yeah, sure. If anybody has, we can talk circumcision or other things like that.
Lots of questions today. So we have about 5 minutes. You know the routine. Please come up to the mic, tell us your name and what you're studying, and it's your chance to ask about the early Mediterranean.
I frightened them.
My name is Tyler Burbidge. I'm an international relations major. At what point do you start to see a change in this older form of identification, the type of identification that we have today with, you know, cards and all that kind of thing? Mm-hmm.
There actually are attempts in this time period to do that. And so a traveler who wants to play it safe will go to some sort of official entity. It might be a consul, it might be a diplomat, you know, some sort of institutional entity, and get what's called a patente, which is a license, basically, to travel. And it will say a few things. It will say, this is this person. I attest to this person that this person is who he says or she says she is. It says where they're coming from and where they're going, usually. And it will often say whether the plague has broken out where they're coming from. So that can, if you have that document, you can avoid 40 days of quarantine when you get to your destination to ensure that you don't have the slave. So they're using these documents. Sometimes people will actually use images, sketches, paintings, if you're, you know, the upper class. When you're finding out, you know, you're marrying the queen whoever of, or princess whoever of whatever kingdom, you want to know what she looks like, she wants to know what you look like, they'll exchange small paintings so you can recognize each other when you're...
Kind of like Tinder?
Yep. Kind of like Tinder, except you don't have the option to swipe.
So right, thank you.
You get what you get. And don't throw a fit, my wife would say.
Hi, I'm Jess Card. I'm an international relations major. Mm-hmm. I was just curious, you were mentioning when you were talking about the Inquisition, and you mentioned how we have a kind of a misperception of it. And first of all, I was curious, why do you think that occurred? Because I do agree that when I've heard about like the Spanish Inquisition and things, it's all torture and death and all these different instruments they used to get information out of people.
Cool museums, right?
And so I was curious devices. If you know, if you had ideas of why that happened, and as well, what were the differences between the, like this court, the ecclesiastical, and the others? Did they have similar methods of getting information out of people, or was it
good
very
questions?
Different?
Those are great questions, both of them. So the first question, the reason for this is because it becomes kind of an important part of religious polemic in the Reformation. So the black legend, as it's known, is largely invented by Protestant polemicists to besmirch Catholicism and show evidence of kind of the craven violence and immorality of Catholicism. And so they take things that do happen, because people do get put to death and they do get tortured, but they exaggerate it and create this really sort of powerful image that endures to this day. Mm-hmm. And so scholars have completely debunked this and shown that, you know, in purely statistical numbers, without sort of denigrating the suffering that individuals certainly did experience, that those are the exceptions rather than the rule. It's a pretty decent place if you want to get justice.
Okay.
If you don't want to get good justice, go to the civil court, which puts to death way more people.
Okay.
It's the civil courts that are putting, and primarily in Protestant countries, truth be told, that are putting to death women as witches, for example. And so, for the time period, the Inquisition is kind of a pretty effective, rational, organized type of a court.
Okay, thank you.
That. So be guilty of heresy, not of some theft or murder or something like that.
My name is Eric Schaub. I'm a political science major. So I had a question about the piracy with the slave trade.
Mm-hmm.
So if it was so common, was it really disruptive of the economy since they're just taking people?
It's hugely disruptive of the economy, and in some ways also a cornerstone of the economy. And there's a lot that could be said about this. There's some structural kinds of changes that are taking place in the late 16th century that create an environment in which new sources of income have to be identified, and slavery becomes one of them. I don't want to go into too much depth in why that is, but, you know, part of it is a labor shortage. You know, there's a demand for labor in a variety of settings, but especially as rowers. There's just a real shortage. Free men no longer want to sign up for that job, and there aren't enough prisoners to force to do that job, and so they're in great demand.
Okay, thank you.
Does that make sense? Yeah.
Hi, my name is Madeline Cowan, and I'm double majoring in marketing and French. And I was sort of wondering, since the Inquisition seems to have acted as a sort of pseudo-governmental body, where is the overlap between the civil government and the Inquisition?
That's a great question as well. So it depends on where we're looking. The Inquisition, we should probably say Inquisitions, because there are a lot of different ones. The Spanish Inquisition is more beholden to the Spanish crown and functions differently. The Roman Inquisitions are more common in Italy, in Malta, for example, but also in the New World, in Mexico and other parts of New Spain, in India also. And so this is one of the big issues, right? Church and state. And so in a place like Venice, the Venetians are really uncomfortable with the presence of the Inquisition, and they pass laws that require a Venetian nobleman who's not an ecclesiastic, who's not a churchman, to be present for every questioning, right? They want to put a governmental overlay in the Inquisition, and they want to control what happens. This is especially true on some of their frontier fortresses, where they have Muslim soldiers and Protestants, heretics of all sorts, infidels and heretics, but they need their services, so they basically tell the Inquisition, stay out, do not mess with our soldiers. And the church is not happy about that, but is not in a position to enforce its own vision of a purified sort of a society.
So the church never had enough power to kind of override the governmental.
Depends in Rome, sure, right? In Rome, because it's the political power.
Right.
But in Malta, to a larger degree than in Venice, but in Venice, no, not really.
Okay.
Not really.
Thank you.
You bet.
Thanks for your questions, and join me in thanking again Professor Dursteler.